Good morning. Welcome to our service for Sunday morning, August the 14th, 2022, here at First Baptist Church, Colco. Just by way of announcements this morning, our audiovisual fund is something that you can give to week by week if you choose to. We are getting ready to upgrade our AV equipment. We are also taking up Operation Christmas Child. And we have some shopping for school, for the shoeboxes, hygiene items, and school supplies. There are cards down here that are placed here. And thank you if you've already given. And if you want to just give money for someone else to do the shopping, that is also a very good thing. Our food pantry always needs supplies. So if you are able to give to toward the food pantry, that would be great, either in your shopping or, you know, with a cash donation. Our weekly needs, our offering, we encourage you to give each week as the Lord lays on your heart. Tonight, we will not have an evening worship service. D.L. Winter we're having a funeral for him this afternoon. Our visitation will be from 1 to 3 with the service at 3 o'clock, and that will be this afternoon. So we will not be having church tonight. That means that our business meeting is going to move. Our business meeting will be now Wednesday night, August the 17th. August the 17th at lunchtime, our Young at Heart are meeting at 11 a.m. for a meal. And August 28th will be our deacons meeting. This morning we have the joy and privilege for three young people to be baptized. That will be after our choir's call to worship. And we are so happy that these young men have made this commitment to the Lord. Let's go to the Lord in prayer at this time. Yes. Oh, yes. We are feeding DL's family this afternoon after the funeral. Food needs to be here at 2 o'clock. So if you're wanting to have food here, please have it here by 2. The funeral is at 3. Now, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we ask you to be with us this morning as we worship you. We thank you so much for these that are being baptized today. And Lord, we thank you so much that we are gathered here in community, Lord, to worship you. We just praise your name. In Jesus' name.
Lord, hear the rain. come this morning believing that Jesus is the Son of God? Do you believe that He died on the cross for your sins and was raised on the third day? Do you trust in Christ for your salvation? All right. I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen. All right. His name is Hayes Payton, who also can. He doesn't need the block. We need to step over this way a little bit, give a little bit more room, but he also comes this morning having made a public profession of faith. I'm going to ask him the same questions I asked Jace. Do you come this morning believing that Jesus is the Son of God? Do you believe that He died on the cross for your sins and rose again on the third day? Do you trust in Him for your salvation? All right, you answered. That's great. We got to give plenty of room for him to go back, and I got to hope I get him back up. You may want to hold your nose if you'd like to do that. I baptize you, Hayes, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. We got you all with us. Come this morning believing that Jesus is the Son of God. Get there. You believe that He died on the cross and rose again on the third day.
Yes, sir.
Are you trusting in Jesus for your salvation?
Yes, sir.
All right. That's what we needed to hear. All right. You want to kind of cut your hand over your nose? That'll help me out a little bit. Help you out too. I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. We're thankful for those three neat young men and their commitment, profession of faith they made. And at this time, Richard, will you pray for us?
This time, our children will head out to Children's Church with Mr. Tommy. And we will sing. We're going to be singing, I Am Resolved. Thank you. are Christians by our love.
Thank you.
This time you may be turning in your Bibles to 1 Peter 3, verses 13 through 4, 2, as we look at the theme, Dead Center, in 1 Peter 3.
We do want to remind you once again that there'll be no service tonight, so our business meeting will be Wednesday night at 6 o'clock during the Bible study time. And then also Wednesday night at 7 o'clock, our committee on committee needs to meet as we're quickly approaching a new church year, so we have to get everything in order and ready for that. And so committee on committee meeting at 7 o'clock Wednesday night. And also, if you have a bulletin, you'll notice on the back of your bulletin that we're going to start the United Prayer Emphasis again each week starting today. We're going to be going through all the churches in the association praying for each church one Sunday. All the other churches in the association will be praying for us. And so the church to pray for this week is Arbor Grove Baptist Church. Taylor Chisholm is the pastor there. Their revival starts, the meeting starts this morning, goes through Tuesday night. And they also have a soccer outreach at the end of the month. And he asked us to be in prayer for their revival and their mission outreach. And so be in prayer for them this week. Hopefully you've made your way to 1 Peter chapter 3, as we're going to look at verse 13 through chapter 4, verse 2, as we saw three young men come this morning making a public profession of their faith and obedience, with baptism being the theme this morning. I was partially rebaptized with them, as you can see, and that's all right. And I told them if they answered no to any of the questions, then Junior got to baptize them. So they all answered yes, because they didn't want to get held under longer than I did. And so, in all seriousness this morning, in 1 Peter chapter 3, when you get through this whole book, what you'll notice is that Peter is dealing with the church that's scattered throughout Asia Minor. These Christians are facing persecution from the Roman authority, from Nero, from all kinds of different people. We went through a study of this on Wednesday nights with a devotional book that Brother Gary put together. Also, I preached through this book on Sunday nights around the first of the year. But these verses, when you get here, he is writing, is Peter, to people who are under constant severe persecution for the faith. They're not under persecution for doing anything wrong. They're not under persecution or being put on trial because it was something that they had done that deserved those things, but it was because they had proclaimed that Jesus was their Savior. And what we have to understand is these three young men this morning have made that public profession. They have proclaimed this morning that Jesus is their Savior. And so they are now going to face persecution. They are now going to face ridicule. They are going to face peer pressure. There's all kinds of things that they're going to deal with because of the decision that they made today. And it is our responsibility as Christians to disciple them, to train them, to help them to continue to progress, to mature, and to grow in their faith so that they can share their faith with others, so that they can be a witness in the world around them. And what we begin to see this morning is that if we'll be willing to admit it anyway, we all have a tendency to lose direction. I'm not saying necessarily you don't know where you may be going. I mean, we do live in the age where we have GPS that we can pull up on our cars or on our watches or on our phones or some type of smart device, and we can know exactly where we're at, exactly what direction we need to go in. We can have everything mapped out and planned out, but we can still be wandering around hopeless. Without Christ, we are hopeless. Without Christ, we have no peace, we have no joy, we have no hope of eternity. We are hopeless. We may be lost, hopeless, in a sea of activity without any real purpose. But what these three young men this morning, and anyone who has surrendered their lives to Christ, has come to the conclusion of, is that we are no longer hopeless. But this morning we have hope, and we can walk around with real purpose, and we can live with a purpose, understanding that God has a plan for our life. He has a purpose for our life, and that is to honor Him, that is to glorify Him, that is to magnify Him, and to be ready to be a witness for Him at all times. We are to make sure that we have Christ at the dead center of our life. He doesn't need to be on the periphery somewhere. He needs to be dead center. He is to be the center of our being. And that's what we're going to get into as we read verses 13 through 17 of 1 Peter chapter 3, starting out this morning. And who is he that will harm you if you be followers of that which is good? But, and if you suffer for righteousness' sake, happy or blessed are you, and be not afraid of their terror, neither be troubled. But sanctify, that is, reverence the Lord God in your hearts. And be ready always to give an answer to every man that asks you a reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and fear. Having a good conscience, that whereas they speak evil of you as of evildoers, they may be ashamed that falsely accuse your good conversation in Christ. For it is better, if the will of God be so, that you suffer for well-doing than for evil-doing. Let's pray. Lord, we come to you this morning. We thank you for this privilege that we have this morning to gather in your house and worship and fellowship together as brothers and sisters in Christ. Lord, we're thankful for your presence here this morning, that your Holy Spirit is moving and he is working. And Lord, we pray that he spoke to hearts during the Sunday school time this morning, dear Lord. And now that we've entered into this worship service together, that he is still speaking, that you are still working, and that you are still drawing people closer to you. And maybe there's someone here this morning who hasn't surrendered their life to you, and they need to do that before they leave here today. Or maybe there are other decisions that need to be made this morning, dear Lord. I pray that we would be found being obedient to you and to your Holy Spirit. And Lord, we pray all these things now in Jesus' name. Amen. The first thing that we notice in verses 13 through 17 is we think about Jesus being dead center, Christ being at dead center in our life, is that when Christ is the center of our being, we will conduct ourselves as people of hope. We are people of hope. We are not like those people who are wandering around that think they have it all figured out, that think they have it all planned out and they have it all mapped out and they know what direction they're going in, but really they're just lost in a sea of activity without any real purpose. But we are people of hope this morning. If you have surrendered your life to Christ this morning, you have a living hope. Jesus is no longer in the tomb. He died on the cross, and he was placed in a borrowed tomb, and he rose again on the third day, and the stone was rolled away so that we could know that he is alive, and that he ascended into heaven, and that he is seated at the right hand of the Father, ever interceding for you and me. And so we have hope that the world does not have this morning. There are people out there wandering around without hope. And our hope is in Christ. Our hope is not in a religious institution. Our hope is not in a political party. Our hope is not in a bank institution or a financial institution or any of those things. Our hope is in Christ. These three young men this morning have professed that they have placed their hope, their trust in Christ, and have surrendered their lives to him. If you have been saved, you're in the same boat that they're in. Your hope is in Christ. And as Christians, we are to function with joy. And you may say this morning, Brother Patrick, do you realize what I'm going through? Do you realize I have this health issue, or a family member has this thing going on, or I have all this stress and the burden? The first week of school just wore me out and it completely wiped me out. I've already been robbed of my joy. Our joy is not based on circumstances. Our joy comes from our relationship with Jesus Christ. If Paul can write from a Roman prison to the church at Philippi and talk to them about the blessed hope and the joy that he has as a believer in Christ while he was constantly chained to other Roman soldiers, if Peter, who was under persecution from the Roman authorities and Nero, and these Christians as well that he's writing to in 1 Peter, were facing constant severe persecution and had scattered into other parts of the world and could still have joy, then you and I are to live with joy today. Because our hope is not in anything that this world has to offer. Our hope is based on our relationship with Jesus Christ. And so our hope is no longer found in meaningless and insignificant things. Our hope is not found in who the Super Bowl champion or the Major League Baseball champion is who wins the World Series. Our hope is not found in any of those things. Those things, yes, we cheer for those people, those teams, we follow those teams, we know all kind of information and stats, but those are really insignificant. Our hope is found in Christ. And what Peter was trying to get these people to see is that in verse 13 he said, "Who is he that will harm you if you be followers of that which is good? But and if you suffer for righteousness' sake, blessed are you, and be not afraid of their terror, neither be troubled." Peter said it's not a matter of if it happens, it's a matter of when it happens. We're all going to face persecution. We're all going to go through trials and tests in our walk of faith. And so we now know that our hope is found in Christ and that Christ defeated death. Christ defeated the grave. And so we no longer have to fear the wrath of God as Christians. We are under His mercy. We are under His grace. We have the privilege of going to Him and sitting in His presence. And so we no longer fear death and destruction. And what Peter was trying to get these Christians to see, the church to see that was scattered throughout Asia Minor, is that they needed to sanctify. That is, they needed to surrender their hearts fully to the Lord God, and they needed to be ready always to give an answer to every man that asked them a reason of the hope that they have in meekness and fear. We all have a testimony. Remember a couple weeks ago, Brother Ken Hester talked about that in one of his revival sermons. He said we all have a testimony and we all need to take time to write out our testimony so that we know and have the assurance of what our testimony is of faith and then be willing to share that testimony with others. Send a letter to someone, send a text to someone, be ready to witness at all times to what Christ has done for us. So what we see, first of all, in these verses 13 through 17, and it was that when Christ is the center of our being, we will conduct ourselves as people of hope. We are people of hope this morning. Secondly, in verses 18 through 22, when Christ is the center of our being, we are dead to sin. Now, I don't want you to misunderstand what I'm saying here. It doesn't mean that you won't still be tempted to sin. It does not mean that you may occasionally sin, but what Peter is talking about and what Paul would write about in other places, specifically in the book of Romans, is that when Christ is the center of our being, we are no longer constantly living in sin. We will flee from sin. And whenever we do sin, we will quickly admit that sin, confess that sin, so that we are back in right standing with God. That's what he's saying here. In verses 18 through 22, he said, "For Christ also hath once suffered for sins." Aren't you glad that he only had to suffer once so that you could experience eternal life, so that you could know of the hope of salvation this morning? The just, Christ, who had done nothing wrong, who had never sinned, was willing to take your sin upon himself, was willing to take your suffering upon himself, was willing to take your shame, your pain, your punishment upon himself so that you could experience eternal life, so that you could walk around with hope this morning, so that you could have joy this morning in your life, no matter what season of life you may be in. For Christ also hath once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might do what? Bring us to God. There was a gap there that we were never going to be able to cross. We would have never been able to work our way across that gap. We've never been able to spend our way across that gap. There was no way we were getting there apart from Christ being willing to die for our sin. Being put to death in the flesh, but quickened, that is, made alive by the Spirit. And so what we see here this morning with the symbol of baptism is that these three young men came this morning admitting that at one time they were dead. They were walking around dead in their trespasses and sin, but they have been saved. And they are now alive, made alive by the Spirit. And so we don't have to walk around as dead men this morning. But we can walk around with hope and we can walk around with joy because we have been made alive through our faith in Jesus Christ. It is why we gather together on Sundays is to celebrate our Savior. We are here this morning to celebrate the fact that Jesus died for our sin and that He rose again and that He is seated at the right hand of the Father, ever interceding for you and me, as I've already said this morning. That's a part of why we gather together. We can encourage one another. We can disciple one another. We can build one another up. But we are here this morning not for ourselves, but to worship Him, to magnify Him, to glorify Him. The problem is that we have too many church members who say that they're saved who spend Sundays celebrating with the dead rather than in church celebrating with the living and worshiping the Savior that was willing to suffer for their sin so that He might bring us to God and make us alive by the Spirit. In verses 19 and 20, he said, by which also he went and preached unto the spirits in prison, which sometime were disobedient, when once the long-suffering of God waited in the days of Noah while the ark was preparing, wherein few, that is eight souls, were saved by water. The like figure whereunto even baptism doth also now save us, not the putting away of the filth of the flesh, but the answer of a good conscience toward God by the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who is gone into heaven and is on the right hand of God, angels and authorities and powers being made subject unto Him. For time purposes this morning, what I'm going to say about this section of verses is that Peter is saying the gospel had been preached. In Noah's day, the gospel was preached and only eight souls responded. In Jesus' day, the message was preached. In the book of Acts, the message was preached. The message is still being preached today. The Holy Spirit is still working and He is still moving. And God is still drawing people unto Himself. It's up to you, though, to surrender your life to Christ. How are you going to respond to the gospel? When you hear the message proclaimed, how are you going to respond? You're not going to answer for how someone else responds. You will answer for how you respond. And so how have you responded to the gospel? Have you surrendered your life to Christ? Have you admitted that you were dead in your trespasses and sin? And if you had died in that moment, that you would have spent an eternity separated from the love of God in hell? Do you believe that Jesus is the Son of God, that He came to this earth, lived a sinless life, died on the cross, was placed in that borrowed tomb, and rose again on the third day? Do you know? Have you placed your faith, your trust in Jesus Christ? Because when Christ is the center of our being, the ordinance of water baptism becomes a symbol of the inner regeneration that took place in your life. These three young men were not saved whenever they were baptized this morning. They were already saved. They were just making a public knowledge of their salvation. They were admitting that an inner regeneration had taken place in their life. And by the way, they were totally immersed because the idea, if you go back and look at Matthew chapter 28 and the Great Commission, Jesus says that the disciples were to go and immerse the world with the gospel. It is a symbol of what has already taken place in their lives. Generation. They are saying that they have died to self and that they were raised a new creature in Christ. It's a picture of what Paul was talking about in the book of Romans, in Romans chapter 6. In Romans chapter 6, he points this out. He gives us what we need to hear concerning this being dead to sin. He said, God forbid, in verse 2, how shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death? Therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. For we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall also in the likeness of his resurrection. And so the challenge for us this morning as believers is to disciple these young men and to show them how to walk in newness of life. And to teach them how to walk in newness of life. The last thing that we'll notice this morning in verses 1 and 2 of 1 Peter chapter 4 is that when Christ is the center of our being, we are alive to God's will. That's the purpose of walking in newness of life. We are now alive to God's will. Water baptism testified to their desire. And if you have been saved and been baptized, it testifies to your desire and commitment to exclusive loyalty to the will of God. That's why he says here in verses 1 and 2 of chapter 4, for as much then as Christ hath suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves likewise with the same mind. For he that hath suffered in the flesh hath ceased from sin, that he no longer should live the rest of his time in the flesh to the lust of men, but to the will of God. How are we spending our time as believers? Are we living that time, doing the will of God, pursuing the will of God, walking in newness of life, or are we using the time to continue to pursue the lust of the flesh? What we see this morning through the symbol of baptism and through what Peter said in these verses is that when Christ is the center of our being, we are people of hope. That's one of the statements that these young men made this morning. That they have placed their faith, their trust in Jesus Christ, and he is their living hope. They have made a commitment this morning to walk in newness of life. They have made a statement this morning that they will be alive to God's will. And so it is our responsibility as parents, as family members, as brothers and sisters in Christ to help them to pursue God's will for their life. To pray for them, to pray with them, to disciple them, to get them involved in the activities of the church so that others can help disciple them, so that they can grow, so that they can progress, so that they can mature, so that they can make an impact in the classroom, that they can make an impact in their homes, they can make an impact in the community. Wherever it is they are, they can be shining their light for Christ because they see us shining our light. They see us making an impact. They see us making a difference in the world around them. These three young men this morning have testified that they have died to sin and now will live for Christ. Have you made that same commitment? Have you surrendered your life to Jesus Christ? Have you died to sin so that you can truly live for Christ? If you have not, today is the day of salvation. You can know Jesus as your Savior before you leave this place today. As Miss Melinda comes, we'll pray and prepare for our hymn of invitation.